is KMed Concept. So today actually we are going to discuss about synaptic heart defects, or we can say right to left shunts. So just like how we remember left to right shunt with the help of 3 D's, now we are going to remember right to left shunt with the help of 5 T's. So let's see what are those 5 T's. Tetralogy of Fallot, truncus arteriosus, transposition of great vessels, tricuspid atresia, total anomalous pulmonary venous rupture. So these are the 5 T which will result in a synaptic heart defect, in which blood is flowing from right side of the heart to left side of the heart. So in our subsequent videos, we will be discussing each of these topics. So today we are going to start with tetralogy of Fallot. So as the name states, tetralogy means something compressing of 4 constituents. So let's see what are the constituents in tetralogy of Fallot. First one, VSD, ventricular septal defect, overriding aorta, right ventricle hypertrophy, and pulmonary stenosis. So these are the 4 main constituents, or we can say that tetralogy of Fallot compresses of VSD, overriding aorta, right ventricular hypertrophy, and pulmonary stenosis. So this itself gives us an idea that obviously this is gonna be a very potentially fatal situation, because all these 4 things are there together, right? So what actually happens in tetralogy of Fallot is, due to pulmonary stenosis, the blood will not be flowing much to lungs, right? So what happens is, the blood will be staying back in right ventricle and leading to right ventricle hypertrophy. So we can say that pulmonary stenosis will result in right ventricular hypertrophy. Okay, so it's not something like blood is not at all flowing, blood is flowing but with huge difficulty. So because of this reason, they produce a particular murmur, ejection systolic murmur. Okay, so now we have resulted in right ventricular hypertrophy. And what really happens here is, now the pressure between right ventricle and left ventricle will be equal. So because they are equally enlarged, so obviously the pressure will be equal on both sides. So when this pressure is equal, blood will flow from right to left. Even though VSD is there, VSD we already learned that it is left to right shunt, right? But even though there is VSD is there, because of equalizing of pressure between right ventricle and left ventricle, VSD will be silent, okay? So even though VSD is there, blood will be flowing from right to left. So this is a short pathophysiology of tetralogy of Fallot. And now when it comes to the points you have to keep in mind, definitely I said that this is a synaptic heart defect, cyanosis will be seen. But cyanosis is directly proportional to severity of pulmonary stenosis. Okay, so that means if there is more pulmonary stenosis, the baby will be appearing more blue in color, right? More cyanosis will be seen. And what about ejection systolic intensity? In ejection systolic intensity, we can say that they are inversely related to pulmonary stenosis. Because I said that as blood is flowing through pulmonary artery, due to pulmonary stenosis, there will be some difficulty. So that difficulty will result in an ejection systolic murmur. But that intensity of sound is inversely related to pulmonary stenosis. So if there is more pulmonary stenosis, we can say that the intensity of ejection systolic murmur will be less. So these are the main things you have to keep in mind. And now when it comes to the main clinical features, you have to keep in mind cyanosis obviously, and second one, clubbing of fingers. And just like the other heart defects, here there is nothing related with S1 sound or S2 sound, so we can say that there is a normal S1 and there is a single S2. So what we actually get is an ejection systolic murmur and cyanosis, right? And what else we can see? We can see polycythemia and a blood test. These are the main things. And when it comes to X-ray, actually we are able to see a boot-shaped heart. So what is the reason for this? Because pulmonary artery segment will be absent. So in X-ray, as we are not having the X-ray right now here, you can imagine that it's a kind of boot-shaped heart. So this is all about the main clinical features. But I'd like to bring your attention towards something known as anoxic spells. What is actually anoxic spells? They are paroxysmal attacks of dyspnea. So they are actually dyspneic attacks. So how is it seen in a baby? What happens is, baby will be sleeping and after waking up, baby starts crying, and what happens here is baby suddenly turns bluer in color and they undergoes dyspnea. Okay, so baby starts facing dyspnea and appears more blue in color. So and then what happens is baby will lose consciousness. So this is a flow chart of what is actually happening in anoxic spells. And the second important thing is we can see the squatting position. And a grown-up child, we can see that whenever he or she face dyspnea as well as appear blue in color, they will suddenly start sitting in squatting position. Squatting position is knee to chest position. Okay, so what is the reason for this? Because they personally feel very much better when they get into a knee to chest position in order to get rid of anoxic spells. So in the treatment also we can say that in order to treat anoxic spells we can practice with the knee to chest position, then humidified oxygen, morphine and such. Okay, so these are the main treatments for anoxic spells. Propranolol, so these are all non-dress. Okay, so these are all about anoxic spells. So that's all for today, and I feel everything is fine, and this is actually a very potentially fatal situation, and we also have to manage it surgically because this knee to chest position, humidified oxygen, these are only for managing anoxic spells. So surgery can be done as a definitive treatment or as a palliative treatment where the arteries are being anastomosed. So I hope everything is very much clear. I'm signing off for today. Thank you.